leadership is not to put greatness into people, but to elicit it. For the greatness is there already, said Scottish novelist and historian John Buchan. As leadership development becomes a critical problem faced by most CEOs, more and more leaders and organizations now realize the need to create and nurture leaders for tomorrow. As John F. Kennedy said, leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. And keeping that very thought in mind, the Avagma Online School, backed by 24/7 Learning and Jack Welch Institute of Management, have joined hands to create India's business leaders and prepare them to deliver top results in their companies and careers. But what are the hurdles leaders today face, and how can they overcome it? Suresh Venkat asked the experts.
One of my all-time favorite quotes, it was famously on the desk of media mogul Ted Turner, it's on my desk today, and it's the sentence I use most in my life. And he famously said, either lead, follow, or get out of the way. Nobody could have said it better than Ted Turner. So my first question is for Sudhanshu Vats. There's so many books written about leadership, so much talk about leadership, so much navel-gazing about leadership. Why is leading so hard?
I think you build leaders when you are in the thick of things, in the market. And I think that's when you build leaders. And academic education need not guarantee a good leader. A very competent, skilled manager need not, again, guarantee a good leader.
Okay.
So I think it's in that context that building this is very difficult.
Right. Let me take that point to Dr. Daniel Shapiro. Dr. Shapiro, are leaders born or can they be created?
Well, we firmly believe, and in fact, this is a direct quote from Jack, that great leaders aren't just born, but they are made. Okay. And one of the important approaches, and perhaps the reason there are so many books on leadership, is that there is a instinctive hope, and we think it's well-founded, that there is something ultimately formulaic in at least producing a foundation for leadership. There, the foundation and principles are there, they're available, and the opportunity to acquire them and then use them as your skill allows you to is the next step. But we certainly believe that leadership can be taught.
Mr. Sukumaran, same question to you. Why is it so hard to find good leaders? Why is it so hard to be a good leader? What are the real challenges there?
Corporates normally struggle with one major issue in terms of identifying leaders. It's not so much into getting them from a technical point of view. It's basically from the behavioral side and a cultural fit.
Okay.
And that's where we find it extremely difficult. You could train a person, you could get him on board, but really to get him fitted into the culture and also to embed him into the organization becomes one of the most toughest things.
Dr. Banerjee, one of your challenges is to find and train leaders within the SR group. In order to do that, you need to be a leader yourself. But you're a leader yourself, and my question to you is this, and I'd like an honest answer. How do you spot your own flaws and make sure that your own flaws, you're not masking them with anything else? When you're saying, what about the chinks in your leadership?
One of the things we very strongly advocate inside our own organization is a process called individual awareness profiling, which is when you actually use psychometrics and other instruments to be able to get more insights into yourself. So to answer your question, I use some of those for myself to be able to understand my own orientations, my own compulsions better,
okay,
so that I'm able to drive what I'm doing on my job with more honesty and more authenticity.
Dr. Shapiro, I want you to react to what Banerjee said about a leader having to introspect. Do leaders have structured introspection programs? How do you teach a leader who's already at the head of organization how to lead further and how to introspect and how to spot flaws in his or her own leadership style?
Whether we're talking about someone who's preparing for their very first leadership role or someone who's already in an advanced position and looking to be a more effective leader, there's still systems and frameworks. We believe also in a lot of peer-to-peer learning and the way we approach things to make sure the groups of people who can use each other as sounding boards are there to bounce ideas off of. But similar to my response to your earlier question, regardless of where someone is in their leadership development, there are tools, there are systems, and they can be taught and explained to people who want to advance their leadership skills.
Mr. Sukumaran, all the tools and all the different foundations and education programs cannot dismantle a leader's ego. What happens in your organization when a leader who's overcome by his own ego cannot see his or her flaws? How do you deal with that from where you sit?
Actually, it's one of those major blocks in any kind of leadership development. And one of the tools which I found fairly useful in corporate is that the 360 degree makes a big difference in terms of giving a feedback to an employee.
Okay.
But more importantly, we also do small little workshops with the subordinates to put the leader in the hotspot.
Okay.
And, you know, actually give him feedback.
A bit of role-playing and scenario building. Okay.
Face-to-face feedback.
Now, I'm going to go back to another quote that I read a little while ago, which I like a lot, which says, management is knowing how to do something well, but leadership is knowing what to do. Yeah. Right? So most managers are very efficient doers once they know what to do. We have many institutes of management in India, but no institutes of leadership in India. Is that a flaw?
Having institutes of leadership may not be the right thing to do, because okay. I think institutes of leadership are organizations in some ways. And I think because that's where you practice. You've got okay. to practice your style based on the qualities which are needed to be a good leader.
Okay. Dr. Banerjee, I'm going to come to you with the mm-hmm. same question. Mm-hmm. I'm sure at the SR Group, you hire a lot of management grads from
Correct.
The premier B schools in India. So if you were to intervene in management education in India to infuse greater leadership qualities in the students there, mm-hmm. would you say more practical experience while they're studying, greater interaction with industry?
I think it rests back on what is your selection criteria. What are you actually looking at when you bring people into a management school? Unfortunately, it's just your grades. I mean, it's only your academic excellence that is placed, premium on. I think it's a more well-rounded personality, the ability to be able to communicate and influence people. These are key areas which you find most MBA graduates falling short of.
That's a scathing indictment of the Indian education system. I'm going to the Dean of the Jack Welch Management Institute, Dr. Shapiro. Dr. Shapiro, we heard from your Indian counterparts about their experiences with the Indian B school system and hiring grads. My simple question to you, management and leadership, what's the key difference between the two? And is there a key difference between the two?
Well, there's a substantial difference between the two. Management tends to be focused on the present, focused on processes, focused on getting jobs done. Leadership is primarily focused on the future and
okay.
in helping other people and helping organizations or people. And what a leader has to do is make sure that the people can do their jobs most effectively.
Okay. I'm going to go to Mr. Sukumaran once again with a related question. Often great managers who tend to be in companies for long periods of time are excellent individual workers. They're extremely good at their jobs, whether it's analytical or linguistic or cultural, and fail as leaders because they don't know how to handle people. But the only way organizations seem to know how to reward people is to make them more senior and get them to manage people. In your group, how do you manage this problem? How do you identify individual talented stars who may never be leaders in their life and still give them a meaningful role to perform?
I think the biggest difference between a manager who has been there for quite some time and who's picked up all the strings as far as the organization is concerned is that he has the necessary wherewithal to manage within the culture of the organization.
Okay.
But in terms of leadership, I think one of the biggest differentiators is the appetite for risks. Now that part of it is something which, he or she is not able to cope with it. But what we find is that whenever there are critical missions, whenever there's a joint venture or there's an acquisition, some of these people are put onto some of these critical tasks and they really prove the mettle.
Okay.
And these are some of the crucibles where, better than even an assessment center, we can
okay.
actually see them on the job flourishing. Some of them flourish, some wither. But then the point is the ones who flourish are really people who can grow up to be a leader.
I'm going to change the topic of conversation just a little bit. Sudhanshu, you spent 20 years at Hindustan Lever, now known as Hindustan Unilever. Among the many other attributes that Unilever globally has and Hindustan Lever, now Hindustan Unilever has in India, is its reputation as a CEO factory. The CEOs of the top 20 companies in India, highly likely that 10 of them would be from Levers, including Sudhanshu himself, who's now the CEO of Viacom 18. My question to you is simple. What is this magical thing you do at Levers that turns everybody into a CEO?
Mentoring program, there is coaching program, there is buddy program. There is room for people to make mistakes and learn. And I think I must also not underestimate the quality of input which comes into it.
Okay.
I must tell you
And you
that
hire from a lot of the premier B
yes,
schools in
therefore
India.
There is something to be said about our management institutes as well, because that is hygiene. You've
okay.
got to build from there. We've also been fortunate as an organization to be challenged from time to time.
Okay.
I think when you're challenged as an organization, that is where the real mettle of the organization and the true leaders comes out.
Dr. Banerjee, what Sudhanshu said about Levers is all very well. They had institutional processes. They had great leaders in the past who set up systems. And those systems have endured long after those leaders have departed from the company. The thing he didn't mention is that it cost Levers a lot of money to do that.
Sure.
It costs a lot of money. It costs a lot of time. And critically, it takes up a lot of leadership bandwidth in order to do this for benefits that may accrue 10 years down the line.
Right.
Most leaders are focused on this quarter or next quarter.
Oh, yeah.
How do you solve this problem? When you need leaders to act in the long term, but they're judged in the short term.
I think one of the things that worked greatly for us was we segment talent on performance and potential. So we know who who we want to invest in and how much.
Okay.
So it's not everything for everyone. It's segmented, and therefore we decide what kind of actions we need to take for different groups of people. But growing our own talent is high on the agenda of CEOs.
It's critical and cannot be negotiated.
Absolutely.
It's a non-negotiable.
Absolutely.
I'm going to go to Mr. Sukumaran once again. If it's such a no-brainer that companies must identify, nurture, and promote talent, why don't so many companies do it? Why are so many companies falling short?
I think it has got something to do with the kind of business growth life cycle they have been in.
Okay.
If some of the companies, like typically the infrastructure businesses, which has had an exponential growth, they did not really plan for it.
So because really, they're too busy growing the company, too busy being part of the explosion.
All of a sudden, so therefore they were stuck with this whole thing. But really, if you see typically a brick and mortar kind of a company, there have been this typical pipeline which has been there, you know, first initially the management trainees, the managers, and then the future leaders.
So it's a life stage issue of the business, of which life stage and what kind of economy you're operating in. Jack Welch once famously said that my biggest trait is that I hired people smarter than me. Now that's easy to say, Dr. Spiro. Mm-hmm. In practice, it's extremely hard to deflate your own ego and say, I will hire a guy smarter than me, because the reality of the decision is that that guy could replace you before you know it.
Well,
so how do leaders deal with this problem?
Well, in fact, by recognizing that one of the things a leader is supposed to do is always be looking for his or her replacement.
Okay.
That's one of the responsibilities, to make sure that there's a sustainability in the organization.
And that doesn't cause high levels of insecurity in the leaders themselves who are doing the choosing?
A confident leader,
okay,
in fact, would be drawn to that.
Okay. All right, so that's another quality you need to be a leader, confidence. Okay, one more change of subject. I'm going to go to a larger problem that we have in India. We have the largest pool of employable people in India, 60% of India being under 25 years, high level of college education, they have English education, they have engineering education, but almost every single company in India says we have no talent to hire from.
I think this is a huge challenge. There needs to be a lot more done in this area. I think there needs to be more interaction between academia and the corporates. There needs to be more support provided by corporates to be able to make sure the quality of education provided, a lot more backward integration into educational institutions to up the quotient, because the quality of teaching, teachers, all of that is suspect in a lot of these schools.
Building on Dr. Banerjee's point of view, so basically putting a lot of focus on vocational studies. No. Also putting a focus on letting people study at their own pace,
okay,
or learn at their own pace. Study is not the right word, learn at their own pace. And therefore, that's where, again, things like the Jack Welch Institute or these places come in, where you could choose to learn at a little later in life, but yet be developed, I think, as a leader. And if we look at some of the developed Western societies, that's what happens. And I think the second one, where I personally feel government has begun some initiatives already, but more needs to be done, is I think while we have lots and lots of engineering institutes or management institutes, I think the quality institutes are still very few and far between.
Dr. Spiro, we just briefly touched about the role of technology in learning. Once upon a time, all of us just went to brick and mortar schools. We sat, one teacher, 50 students. Then came the great promise of e-learning. But as Anil mentioned, e-learning sometimes is a little underwhelming because it isolates the learner from his peer group. And now we have blended learning, we have social learning. What is the cutting edge? What is the bleeding edge of technology in the learning space?
At the Jack Welch Management Institute, for example, each one of our sections of an electronic class has a maximum of 20 people in it.
Okay.
And those 20 people, think about the classroom setting you were in, how often each one of us in our classroom experience hid in the back of the room and never went through a whole class without saying one word. Well, there's only 20 people in a section, you can't hide. You're engaged, you are sharing your opinions, your classmates are sharing your opinions with you. So technology and a thoughtful design around technology-facilitated education, in fact, can remove some of those underwhelming components and make it far more engaging and, more importantly, far more accessible for working managers and professionals to integrate learning with their busy careers.
Mr. Sukumaran, often we get this reaction from people in organizations when they're asked to do video conference calls, they're asked to do blended learning programs or e-learning programs, they'll say, no, I'll just catch a flight and go there. It's much easier if I can do this face-to-face. Is this old school mentality, or is there a real problem with managers adopting technology?
No, I think basically most of the managers use technology and they also learn.
Okay.
But the point is how well they are able to utilize it. in terms of application.
And how good the technology is and how user-friendly and how sexy it is, frankly.
Yes, that's true. That's true. So they enjoy doing that. But then the question of application. So there comes the culture of the organization as to how well we are able to blend it into projects and also to ensure that these people are going to use this knowledge in the day-to-day working.
Right. I'm almost at the end of my discussion. I'm going to ask one or two final questions and closing remarks. I'm going to quote once again from Ted Turner. He said, lead, follow, or get out of the way. Dr. Banerjee, do we talk too much about leadership and not enough about followership? Let's be frank, not everybody can be a leader. Absolutely. We also need certain traits and people who can follow a leader.
Sure.
What are the traits of a good follower?
Followers for us are people who are essentially aligned meaningfully,
okay.
Who will essentially try and take out the disruptive elements from whatever enables a great performance within the team,
mm-hmm.
and influence co-workers positively to be able to get the job done. So they're not yet ready to be able to contribute strategically. Their seasoned judgment still needs to develop over a period of time. But typically, in my opinion, great followers eventually make great leaders.
All right. Excellent. Well said. Sudhanshu, my final question for you. In an era of globalization, is there something called Indian leadership? Is there something unique that Indian managers need to have to do when they're dealing with India? Is there an Indian trait that you've noticed?
There are many, actually, which I can talk about, and the most famous one is Jugaad.
Okay.
I think understanding of Indian culture and this entire thing about Jugaad, and utilizing Jugaad for the right things. I think, which is the speed of doing things and basically being innovative about doing things. And for us, both are very critical as a country. Speed is important if you want to catch up.
True.
You cannot catch up without speed. Innovation is important if you want to do it differently at a lower cost and more efficiently. So I think both are important, and therefore understanding of Indian culture and therefore taking Jugaad to its logical and next level is very important.
Dr. Spiro, my final question for you. I'm going to ask you the same question from a global perspective. In a globalized world with an American CEO and Guatemalan workers and African co-workers and colleagues who are sitting in Australia, what is leadership in that context? If you're geographically going to be separated from your team, you may never ever see them more than once a year. How do you lead people that you can't see in this globalized world?
Well, it is becoming the norm in many ways rather than the exception. But the fundamentals are no different,
whether it's physical leadership or virtual leadership.
The same qualities, and understanding the importance, making sure there's a clear vision that people can act upon and lead into a clear strategy for the organization, making sure that there's candor in the communication between the people who are working together in that organization, and being honest.
Mr. Sukumaran, my final question for you. All evening we spoke about the qualities that great leaders have, the qualities that build great leaders. I want you to tell me the qualities that destroy leadership in an organization.
I think the first word is ego.
Okay.
I think that's clearly one of the biggest blocks in destroying leadership. The second big block I find as a cultural thing in the organization is that we have this typical old insider versus outsiders, especially when we scale up and we really engage leaders from outside or we even hire
leaders. You have the old guard resisting the
new guard. Old guard resisting the new one. And that is another major predicament as far as leadership development is concerned. And the third thing which I find very, very unique to India is that we just don't want to hire smarter people than us.
We don't want to hire smarter people. All right, that brings us to the end. Dr. Banerjee, Sudhanshu, Dr. Spiro, and Mr. Sukumaran, thank you very much for being part of the discussion. Thank you for listening patiently. I hand the stage back to Karthik now for the next part of the evening.
Here, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to present the founder of the Jack Welch Management Institute. Here is Jack Welch live from New York.
Well, it's a great honor for me to talk to you and discuss with you a little bit about our dreams for the Jack Welch Management Institute. And this step to India for us is the first real step in our globalization efforts. We're growing rapidly in the US. Our courses are designed to teach people how to win. Our certificate course in leadership is all about how to hire, how to fire, how to motivate, how to lead, how to excite, how to differentiate. And these things will teach managers their major responsibility, which is building great teams, because great teams are what create winning organizations. It'll teach managers exactly how to differentiate between Project A, Project B, and Project C, and give them the tools they need to become more effective global leaders. So it's my great pleasure to take these tools, bring them to India, and work with our teams in India now in our new venture to build great leaders from this school in the Indian economy.
The Avagma Jackwell Executive Program, backed by 24/7 Learning, aims to bring the best of both worlds to Indian corporations. Jack Welch's management expertise and an online executive certificate program with global curriculum relevant to Indian corporations with India-centered case studies right at their doorstep.